73 in your Red Pew Bible, sir, would invite you to follow along. This is in John's Gospel, the last miracle that Jesus performs before he is taken captive by the Romans. And this is the kind of the final miracle of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. And it's the one that gets Jesus into the most trouble. This text as well is also one of the places in John's Gospel where we see Jesus, the Son of God, experiencing and expressing some of the most deepest emotions in the shortest verse in Scripture is John 11:35. But in that, those two words, Jesus wept, we hear a God who experiences the whole range of human emotions just as we do. John 11, beginning with verse 14. Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him." And Thomas, one of his disciples, who was called the twin, and his fellow disciples said, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and to Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house consoling her saw Mary get up quickly and go out, and they followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who came out with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. The story goes on, but for the purpose of our sermon series today, we'll end right there with a little bit of a cliffhanger. Go home and read the rest of the story, because it's really, really important. We're in week 4 of this final week of this sermon series, Living Faith, and thinking about the whole realm and gamut of emotions that so many of us feel. We began by thinking about joy, week 2 thought through the emotion of fear that grips us, that holds us captive. We thought just last week about anger and disgust, and then today, as we finish up, we think through that emotion of sadness that sometimes just covers us, creeps up on us, on so many of us. this feeling of sadness or grief causes us to weep, causes us to, well, sometimes it causes us to not even be able to function, because we're gripped with depression, we're gripped with sadness. We've been thinking through this sermon series about the whole realm of emotions, the whole range of emotions, and today we ask this question: do people of faith, do they experience sadness? After all, how could a person of faith who has put their trust in Jesus, how could a person of faith who believes firmly in the gift of salvation given to us, how could a person of faith who has received the forgiveness of sins, how could a person of faith ever experience sadness? And I know that sometimes that means that that sadness gets played off as some sort of a weak emotion. I know that sometimes sadness, you know, we say to one another, just get through it, you'll be fine, just get over it. Do people of faith experience sadness? Yes. So many people of faith experience sadness. It's not a matter of if you would have more faith, then you wouldn't be sad anymore. We want to think through this gift of sadness. And then to think, too, about how we can move from sadness to joy. Because we're not called to just dwell in our sadness. And so we're going to ask the question today: how can we move from sadness to joy? How can we live the life that God has intended us, a full and abundant life with a whole realm and range of emotions, from sadness to joy, from anger to happiness, from disgust to satisfaction, from fear to a life fully lived. We've been using just really short clips from this movie Inside Out, which came out in 2016 from Disney Pixar. And so again, just 30 quick seconds on this idea of sadness.
Ever wonder why you feel the way you do? Well, get to know your emotions. When life gets you down, that's when sadness takes over. This is sadness. With a caring touch and a kind heart, sadness leaps into action to let you... I said, sadness leaps into action. Sadness? Oh, sadness. Get to know all your emotions with Disney Pixar's Inside Out, rated PG.
Sadness leaps into action. It leaps into action. So already, sadness leaps into action. That's not true, right? You know. Those of us that have experienced it, those of us that have seen sadness or have experienced sadness, what do we do with it? I know that in particular, in those months when the sunlight is really, really short for us in the Northern Hemisphere, I know that many people experience seasonal affective disorder. It's a very real thing. Counselors and pastors will tell you that they are more busy in the months of February and March than usually any other month throughout the calendar year. I know that in particular when my football teams over the weekend, on Saturday or on Sunday, when they don't play well, that often on Sunday or on... Well, not so much on Sunday, because usually the Badgers do win. They're a pretty good team, right? Yeah, actually, the Packers. You get the point. When your team doesn't do so well, or when something doesn't go quite right for you, that so often sadness grips us. It fills us. It covers us, and it holds us. It doesn't leap into action. It consumes us. So what do we do as people of faith? First, can you mute that computer, Jen?
Mute it?
Yeah. First, it is important for us to recognize and to understand that Jesus wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. It's important for us to begin there. that Jesus is filled with sadness at the death of his friend. It's this curious thing because he's going to raise Lazarus back from life. Sorry, I just gave away the spoiler. He's going to raise Lazarus back to life. But Jesus is moved to tears in John 11:35. I said earlier, it's the shortest verse in Scripture. Our translation in the Red Pew Bibles has it in four words. It's really just two Greek words. Jesus wept. It's the shortest verse, and actually that was Vanessa's confirmation verse. I know a lot of people, you know, they say, well, we have to memorize a verse in Scripture for confirmation. And so a lot of people say, I want to find the shortest verse in Scripture. I let Vanessa do it because she explained to me what that meant, that Jesus weeps. Earlier and then again later, surrounding those two verses, we hear that Jesus is greatly disturbed in spirit. What that means, I've shared with you this before, what that means is it's the kind of tears where it's unconsolable tears. It's the kind of tears where snot is just running out of your nose and you can't control it, filled with grief. I had those tears on my dad's shoulder on my senior year of high school, the last football game that I got to play as a Alfred West terror. I cried on my dad's coat. I remember afterwards embracing him and pulling away after a while and just seeing this whole big snot fest all over his coat. Because I was sad. I was gripped with sadness about not playing football again after high school. It's that kind of those kinds of tears that Jesus is sharing at the death of his good friend Lazarus. Way more important than not playing last football game. I take great joy in knowing that God in the flesh, Jesus Christ, experienced the whole range of emotions, including that kind and that level of sadness. Jesus is filled with sadness. He weeps. He's greatly disturbed in spirit. How do we move beyond sadness? First, know that God is a God of accompaniment, and God dwells with us in our sadness. Three quick points for us to move from sadness to joy. First is this: come to church and cry. I see sometimes in some of you just walking into a sanctuary, this sanctuary or another, that you are filled with sadness. And it is good to cry in the midst of a relationship. It is good to cry in the midst of caring Christian community. It is good to be here in this place and to share our tears. We don't have to always have it all together. In fact, I would be pretty frightened if we did. It is good to share our emotions. Come to church and cry. Be in relationship with one another and share in those incredibly deep moments of sadness. Genesis chapter 1, at the very beginning of Scripture, Adam is by himself. Adam, the man, is by himself. And God says it's not good that man would be alone. Man was created for relationship. Humankind was created for relationship. Come to church and cry. Second, surround yourself with others. Reach out for help. Don't disconnect. When we are sad, it is our, maybe it's our first instinct to pull back and to be by ourselves and to say, well, nobody wants to be around me because I'm sad right now. Reach out to others. The world needs you. Reach out to others. Hebrews chapter 10 says, let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another all the more as you see the day approaching. Reach out for help when you are sad. surround yourself with others. Don't disconnect. Let me preface, or let me add just one quick addendum to that. That it might be good when you are filled with sadness to disconnect from social media. Survey after survey after survey tells us that social media has detrimental effects on mental health. That so often social media causes one another to just get angry, or that social media can indeed lead to some sense of depression or some sense of sadness. So that might be a place to disconnect, but reach out to others. And thirdly, this: get some exercise, move a little bit, and eat real and good food. Your diet is important. What you put in your body matters. Any dietitian will tell you that just filling yourself with junk food will lead to junk. I'm not a great example of this, but eat better and move a little bit. Get outside, go for a walk, invite a friend to go for a bike ride, move a little bit when you are surrounded with those feelings of sadness, so that you might move from sadness to joy, so that you might move from anger to peace, so that you might move from disgust to a sense of acceptance and to a sense of inclusion, and so that you might move from fear to love. I give thanks to God for the whole range of emotions that we feel. I see them each as a gift. When we are sad, know that it is okay. Reach out to others for help. Surround yourself with people who bring you joy. Do some exercise or eat a little bit better than what you have been. And pray. Always and forever, I encourage you to pray. This prayer from St. Francis is perhaps maybe it's the second. Is that the next one? Maybe the second most popular prayer, other than the Lord's Prayer. As we conclude this sermon series, I would invite you to pray with me this prayer of St. Francis. I'm going to move a little bit closer so that I can see it. But pray with me. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me show love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. Amen. And thanks be to God. I invite you to stand. We sing our